Hello everyone and welcome to today's Lab Tools webinar. I'm Catherine Lloydell, Associate Science Editor for The Scientist, and I'll be moderating our discussion. Today, our speakers, Mr. Adam Green and Mr. Klaus Schoner, will discuss how optimization allows researchers to maximize user-specific results and reduce specimen-to-report timelines. We like our webinars to be interactive. We encourage you to send us your questions or comments at any point during the webinar, and the speakers will address these during the Q&A session following the presentation. To ask a question, simply click on the Q&A tab and type your query into the question box located on the right side of your screen. We'll try to address as many of these questions as we can during our Q&A session. The webinar will be archived on the Scientist website, and we will send you the link via email within a couple of days. Please note that you will not be able to download the presentation slides. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank our webinar sponsor, Sartorius. The Sartorius Group is a leading international partner of life science research and the biopharmaceutical industry. With innovative laboratory instruments and consumables, the group's Lab Products and Services division concentrates on serving the needs of laboratories performing research and quality control at pharma and biopharma companies and those of academic research institutes. The Bioprocess Solutions division, with its broad product portfolio focusing on single-use solutions, helps customers to manufacture biotech medications and vaccines safely and efficiently. The group has been annually growing by double digits on average and has been regularly expanding its portfolio by acquisitions complementary technologies. In fiscal 2019, the company earned sales revenue of some 1.83 billion euros. At the end of 2019, more than 9,000 people were employed at their group's approximately 60 manufacturing and sales sites, serving customers around the globe. Our sponsor has provided us with some helpful resources related to today's webinar, and we have posted these in our handout section located on the right side of your screen. You can access and download these documents at any time during the webinar. And with that, let me introduce our speakers, Mr. Adam Green and Mr. Klaus Schoner. Mr. Green will be giving a presentation, and Mr. Schoner will join him to answer audience questions at the end of the webinar. So I'd like to introduce Adam Green. After initially specializing in environmental microbiology in various roles, Adam joined Sartorius in 2014, where he progressed to focusing on the micro and molecular sector. He transitioned from product specialist to product manager, and then finally into his current role of leading the Sartorius Lab Filtration product management team, whilst maintaining ownership of the lab purification portfolio. And Klaus Schoner. After studying biotechnology, Klaus joined Sartorius in 2005 and has specialized in various positions, including validation specialist, technical support, and application development manager in areas related to the filtration of liquids. In his current role as application scientist, he now focuses on life science applications in the field of micro and ultra filtration. So Adam, I'm just gonna check your screen is up. Okay, it looks like we're good. So it's over to you, Adam.
Hi, Catherine. Great. Thanks for that great introduction. And likewise for hosting us on this platform. We're really pleased to be here. So good morning or good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our talk on optimizing lab ultrafiltration workflows from cell culture to diagnostics, which we're really pleased to present to you today. So taking a look at the agenda, we'll start with an introduction, and it really will be an introduction. We'll take a look at Sartorius and ultrafiltration in general, the key principles of ultrafiltration, the terminology and so on. Then we'll take a dive into the applications, and we'll take a look at the optimization considerations for those key applications. And I should say, when we're going through these optimization considerations, if there's any terminology or procedures that isn't made fully clear, not to worry, just keep a note of it. And during the following sections, optimization of the lab ultrafiltration procedures and the sample and device treatment methods, we'll go into those in a little bit more depth. And then finally, we'll end on taking a look at trials and application development with Sartorius today and a brief summary. So why are we here? Why is Sartorius here? Where did it all begin? So in the 1860s, there was the introduction of the cellulose nitrate membranes but that was without any pore sizes, so that was just the material. In the 1960s, then, that technology evolved further so that you could have the graded membrane filters with pore sizes that we know today, such as the 0.2 micron and the 0.45 micron. And this was invented by Backman and Zsigmondy in Göttingen, which is conveniently where Sartorius is headquartered today. In 1927, we came on the scene and we partnered with Zsigmondy to produce the first industrial membranes with the graded pore sizes. So right from the beginning, we were on the scene with membrane filtration. And then, of course, in the 1950s, that technology then spread across the world. So in terms of the ultrafiltration, how did Sartorius come into that? So in the 1990s, a company called Viva Science, a small company based in Gloucestershire in the UK, were heavily involved in ultrafiltration technology and development, and as such became the first inventors of the vertical ultrafiltration membrane in centrifugal devices, which is now the industry standard, and you'll see that in pretty much 90% of centrifugal devices. In 1999, Sartorius acquires Viva Science because of its novel innovation in not just lab ultrafiltration, but also protein purification and cell culture technologies and so on. And right from that year to today, to 2020, as part of Sartorius, multiple novel products have been developed, including the VivaFlow Lab TFF or CrossFlow system, unique hydrosart ultrafiltration membrane in our devices, and including the VivaSpin Turbo range that's are currently some of the fastest on the market, with the latest launch being the Turbo RC product. In 2016, it was quite an exciting time. We managed to essentially build a new state-of-the-art $10 million manufacturing facility in Gloucester in the UK that you can see up with this image in the top right. And it was opened with Prince Anne, which I think everyone was kind of excited about at the time. So ultrafiltration, or specifically lab ultrafiltration, what actually is it? So it's the it's based upon the filtration and separation of macromolecules in the sub-micro range using extremely fine porous membranes. And typically, as you can kind of see, it's used for the concentration or purification of proteins, viruses, extracellular vesicles and macromolecules and nanoparticles. Concentration is certainly the primary kind of application or the primary cause to have the ultrafiltration, but there are some secondary powerful applications such as diafiltration for buffer exchange, desalting, and sample washing. So the difference between an ultrafiltration membrane and a microfilter or a microporous membrane is quite stark. Ultrafiltration membranes are highly asymmetrical and typically include this non-woven support you see down here. The skin layer, this kind of 5 micrometer thick layer, this is where the separation actually occurs. And that level of separation is at such a sub-micron level that it's very fair to say that as part of the process, there's as many biochemical considerations, particularly when you're looking at the very interactive proteins and so on, as well as the physical considerations for separation. And because of that, this is where there's a lot of variation and where optimization can really come into play. Certainly, ultrafiltration is heavily used in academia, biopharma, and diagnostic industries. And as part of that, certainly the cell culture, IVD, and environmental testing workflows, ultrafiltration is relevant. And we'll do a bit of a deeper dive into some of those as we go on. So a key principle here, ultrafiltration membranes are designated according to molecular weight cutoff, MWCO, and this describes the membrane's ability to retain molecules of different sizes. Sartorius has a unique combination of 4 lab ultrafiltration membranes, specifically polyether sulfone, regenerated cellulose, hydrosart, which is our patented, modified and improved version of regenerated cellulose, and then cellulose triacetate. It's worth noting that these different membranes, they can perform equally well, but one type, one membrane may be optimal for a specific sample type or protein, virus, or so on. An example of this is on the right-hand side, where we can see the concentration recovery of a secreted TFF1 protein, which is quite a small protein from gastric cardia cell lines. And we tested the recovery of this kind of tricky small protein with our PES membrane and then an RC competitor membrane. And you can see with our 5 kilodalton cutoff, we achieved percentage recoveries around 44-45%, which is not bad for this kind of difficult, small 6.5 kilodalton protein when you're looking at a 5K molecular weight cutoff. And then interestingly, the RC, although it's 3 kilodalton and you would expect a higher level of retention, actually in both spins shows a lower level of retention. And what we can take from this is that different membranes may offer different recoveries, even with the non-optimal molecular weight to molecular weight combination. So moving on from this, as we kind of mentioned before, the skin is where the separation begins. And it's very important that this always faces the feed stream, as this is the layer that allows the molecular separation. The thicker support is really there to provide that membrane structural stability. But one key point to note is that this is typically a non-woven ester or cellulose. It does vary slightly. But you can get non-specific binding in this support layer. So looking at the compatibilities of just the skin regenerated cellulose or polyethersulfone isn't the end of the story. You should also consider the support layer here, particularly for filtrate studies, as we'll go on to mention. So as this point down here says, it's always good to test sample devices, particularly when you're working to optimize or working with a new molecular target. So for lab ultrafiltration, these membranes are placed into 4 different types of devices to give 4 main methods for lab-based ultrafiltration. First is centrifugal, which is probably by far the most common, pressurization, then tangential flow filtration, otherwise known as cross flow, and then finally static. These methods can be interchangeable or they might be sample specific. And we have some slides a bit later on that kind of show what method might be best for what kind of priority. So taking an overview of the centrifugal method, as you can expect, it'll spin around in a typical lab bench centrifuge, and that force is what will drive that centrifugal force is what will drive separation through the ultrafilter. Typically, they're accepted in most rotors and bockets because they meet the common kind of SBS size, 15-50 mil Falcon tubes and so on. As mentioned, it's usually measured by RCF, relative centrifugal force, which comes in the units of G. It can also be measured in RPM, rotations per minute, but we wouldn't often recommend this because it's not really consistent. The RCF is a constant, whereas you can have maybe an RPM of, let's say, 4,000, but that will incur a different RCF depending upon the length of the centrifugal rotor arms. One point here just to note is that this kind of combination of RCF versus spin time versus the desired concentration factor, measuring that interaction is kind of key for optimization, and we'll talk about that a bit later on. But the benefits of centrifugal are quick speeds, easy to set up, and it allows for wash step and buffer exchange as possible. And for our range, it's kind of everything Viva Spin, Viva Cell, Viva Con, and the odd one out, CentriStart. Now we come on to pressurization. This is using the standard in our gas systems, nitrogen and so on, to pressurize a container such as the Viva cell, but it needs to come with an air pressure controller and the pressurization cap to control and to maintain that pressure. One really nice point is that you'll see that once it's pressurized, these devices can be sat on a shaking platform. And this both increases the speed of filtration, but also enables enough agitation to prevent any membrane fouling, which will essentially slow the process down. Further to that, our VivaSpin 20, which are traditionally a centrifugal device, these can be pressurized with a pressure cap accessory, and they can uniquely be placed in the centrifuge. So as you can expect, that generates some really fast speeds of concentration. Stirred cell vessels are also pressurization devices, and with the rotational blades, it helps to reduce that membrane polarization, which is also kind of the fouling, membrane polarization and fouling kind of mean the same thing in many ways. But those blades can induce some shear stresses, and we'll talk a bit about shear stresses a bit later on. Generally, we'll look at anything from the 5 milliliter to the 100 milliliter volumes for this. benefits is you're not limited by the centrifuge demand. There are low shear stresses due to stable pressure. That's excluding the stud cell vessels in any case. And it allows for the fast speeds when in combination with the shaker platform or the centrifuge. Now we come on to tangential flow filtration. TFF is very relevant to process level, large volumes, you know, up to hundreds and hundreds of liters. For the points in this, we really focus upon lab-based ultrafiltration or lab-based TFF, although a lot of the points are kind of interchangeable and are valid. Just keep that in mind as we go forward. But here with TFF, typically it's in cassette format and the sample is pumped across and sort of in parallel to the ultrafilt layer using a peristaltic pump. And this will be recirculated until the desired concentration factor is met. The pressure in the system, which is needed to enable that pass through, that's generally maintained using a flow restrictor on the outside of the cassette, certainly for our Viva Flow products in any case. One really nice bit is that the diafiltration can occur simultaneously and continuously with the concentration procedure, which is great for protecting your samples. And then likewise, we have devices that are available both as disposable and as multi-use. And as a little tip, when it comes to the multi-use cassettes, they're not reusable indefinitely. There are cleaning cycles and storage cycles. And the better these are carried out, the longer that they will last. Typically, we might see 5 to 10 times, essentially whenever the flux and the speed of concentration reduces to an inhibitory level, then it's time to get a new one. I have met some customers who have used one for almost a year. So there can be some good life if they're maintained, and of course, depending upon the sample. And these will generally go up to 5 liter. So it's a really nice kind of novel range for a lab-based device. The high membrane velocity and turbulence that these slip flow channels provide give excellent flux. And flux is essentially kind of separation efficiency is how I might describe that of the process. They're relatively low cost and simple plug and play operation. And the transparent housing provides visual separation. That's for our Viva Flow in any case. And one key kind of separation between, let's say, a lab-based TFF and a process scale TFF is that lab-based will not require the large capital equipment, the filter holders, the pressure control systems, and so on. And then all the software and the control and recording that you might not need for a lab-based operation. When it comes to TFF, there's a little note here to say that the concentration gradient, which is essentially the level of density of your target at the membrane boundary layer, the more that increases, the more it kind of turns into membrane fouling, which reduces the flux and so on. One of the really nice things of the VivaFlow design is we have this unique flip flow style, and each flip and flow, as it were, causes turbulence that helps to prevent that effect, cause agitation, and reduces any membrane boundary. And that has some quite strong impacts for actually how easy it is to use, and I'll mention these a little bit more when we get into a TFF section of the presentation. And then finally, we have the static concentrators. So here, the sample will pass through the membrane via solvent absorption. It's a walk-away procedure. It can take 1 or more hours for the desired concentration, typically for a 20 times concentration factor. For 10 milliliters of a 0.25 mg per mil protein, it will take about an hour and then increase accordingly, depending on volume and decrease in concentration. It's very useful for shear-sensitive samples. As you can imagine, it's a very gentle procedure. And it's commonly used for urine analysis for the detection concentration of Bence-Jones protein, which is a marker protein for multiple myeloma. And that will go up to around 20 milliliters. Again, no equipment needed, and it can be placed in cold storage, which is good. There are low shear stresses and can be left overnight. So now we can move on to the applications. We've got a nice kind of range here of applications. Hopefully it captures most of the audience. So when we get into the optimization considerations, just take note to whatever's relevant to you, and then we'll probably do a deeper dive onto that in the second half of the presentation. as you can expect, lab ultrafiltration, there's a huge amount of applications and markets, certainly within the life sciences, proteins, viruses, and so on, are very, very, very highly relevant. Diafiltration, using the ultrafiltration membrane, is also a key application, as well as the concentration. It's a kind of secondary method, but it's very relevant to a lot of applications. And then most importantly, why we're kind of here is that those biochemical and physical variables in the UF process mean that really good application knowledge is helpful for procedure optimization to obtain those best practices and results. So we start with some environmental analysis. You can see a typical workflow here. It's very generic. It's not going to be specific for every application, but kind of meets the typical workflow for applications such as seawater trace metal concentration, wastewater virus collection, so on. And here you can kind of see that after a kind of clarification stage, there's then the concentration and then an optional buffer exchange step before moving on to analysis. Typical targets are inorganics, including heavy metal colloids, epidemiological microorganism studies, putative protein and peptides from sewage treatment streams, and et cetera, and nucleic acids for metagenomic studies. I mean, you can't really go one presentation without mentioning COVID these days, particularly when it comes to the life sciences, but certainly we have seen COVID as a huge driver for increasing ultrafiltration applications as part of the concentration for viruses in wastewater analysis. And these methods are still being established, and we're happy to be a part of helping to establish those methods wherever we can. Another kind of novel method is, or relatively niche, is the recovery of high-value inorganic molecules. So this in ink wastewater streams, for example, ultrafiltration comes into play to help to collect and concentrate those high-value particles. So what are the considerations for optimization? So with the inorganics and environmental, harsh chemical solutions may be involved. So do check the cross-reference membrane and device housing chemical compatibilities to make sure there's no pinholes or so on. The samples might be quite viscous or loaded with particulates. So an inline pre-filtration with a depth filter such as the Sartilab P20 can be used. For the epidemiological studies, certainly you want to collect as large a volume as possible. So the TFF, the VivaFlow systems and similar systems are great because they allow you to capture 5 liter of wastewater and condense that down for more accurate diagnosis. And one point to note when it comes to bacteria and viruses is that the membrane choice has a big impact, certainly between bacteria and viruses, but also between bacteria and more so viruses. For example, dead-end filtration will usually damage microbes, so use TFF. A 0.2 PES, 0.2 micrometer PES seem to be optimal for bacteria retention, whereas for virus, typically a virus, let's say more than 30 nanometers, which is quite a wide range, a 100 or 300K PES or RC membrane is best suited. Of course, if there's a virus like the adeno-associated virus, which is more like 20 nanometers, you typically use a lower molecular weight cutoff. And then for nucleic acids, we really see RC and hydrosart as being well suited for those long linear molecules. So moving on to clinical sample prep. Again, a key point of the kind of process here is that you see there's a concentration factor measurement in the workflow. And this is quite important to make sure that the user knows when to stop the concentration, because an optimal volume and concentration factor is normally needed to go into the analysis. So the typical solutions here are urine, cerebrospinal fluid, and biological plasma and blood serum. The applications are primarily for disease marker diagnostics, but also free drug and hormone determination and drug efficiency studies. And generally, they can be split again into two sections, one being concentration to help ensure that accurate positive or negative result, and then also two being deprotonization to remove contaminating blood proteins and so on from the nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy and so on. So for this procedure, you want to make sure there is no contamination. So a pre-rinse or washing step should be carried out to help ensure this, because it will help to prevent any false results and remove the background noise. For many diagnostic studies, a clear separation is kind of needed between those large molecule blood proteins and the smaller metabolite of interest, for example. Ultrafiltration can be used for this separation, but it's very important to note that there's a tenfold size difference is required for true fractionation. So you could separate a 10 kilodalton molecule from a 100 kilodalton molecule, maybe using a 30 or 50 K molecular weight cutoff, but you would not be able to accurately and decisively separate maybe a 30 and a 50 K molecule. So worth keeping in mind. Loss of target metabolites as well through any protein metabolite conjugates is certainly can happen as well. And this can normally be assessed through methods such as capillary electrophoresis. Where the molecule integrity is critical and a concern, in other words, you don't want it to degrade or denature, we'd recommend the static concentrators as they offer the low shear stresses and can be placed in the cold room. So this is an example of a workflow for a clinical sample prep. And I just draw your attention to three key points. You can see a washing step has gone on here with HCl to help remove the glycerol sodium azide that I'll mention a bit later. Second, you can see that there's a second concentration step using a lower molecular weight cutoff following the kind of fractionation step that you can see happen here with a 50K molecular weight cutoff. And then finally, the additional analysis of the protein fraction, just to measure the protein metabolite, you know, conjugate assessment is there also, whilst the metabolites go on for NMR. So analytical sample prep, and this is kind of before liquid chromatography methods, affinity chromatography, almost identical in a general workflow as it was to the diagnostic sample prep. Here, the applications are slightly different. It's often for sample clarification, concentration to a predefined volume for analysis, and diafiltration for rapid buffer exchange and desalting. The low volume centrifugal filters such as the VivaSpin 500 are typically used here, but all the, you know, the deprotonization principles as we just discussed are still relevant for this sample prep also. So where clarification or deprotonization is required, certainly it's worth considering devices with inbuilt sealable filtrate tubes. So you can kind of see this image up here, the Turbo 15RC, the concentrator insert is essentially placed inside a 50 mil Falcon tube. So after concentration, if you want the filtrate, you can just remove that concentrator insert, and then seal the tube back up. So essentially you reduce those manual sample transfer steps. Retention is according to nominal molecular weight cutoffs. And this is really highly relevant for proteins, but it's not always directly relevant to other targets such as exosomes or viruses who don't have molecular weight cutoffs. So here we'd recommend using some selection guides. I'll show you in a little while to help cross-reference to see what is the best molecular weight cutoff membrane for your target. And then finally, for many of these chromatography systems, you need a kind of specific volume range to work with. And for that, we would recommend using the final volume control method to ensure the sample's not over or under concentrated in the centrifuge, which I will also go on to mention later. So then looking at nucleic acid concentration for forensic and other applications, you can see there is a slightly different workflow, but the principle kind of is the same, where after the extraction, ultrafiltration can be used as a crude purification method, but you'll find diafiltration will occur to buffer exchange, as it says down here, that will help to ensure the optimal buffer conditions for the PCR, qPCR, and so on. And then again, you might find ultrafiltration in place as it's used to remove excess primers prior to any further downstream analytics, give a cleaner result. Certainly DNA is the primary target for forensics, but as an example to show how prevalent ultrafiltration is in a range of applications, it's also used for the diagnosis of fire sulfate, for hydrogen sulfide poisoning, ethylene glycol presence in blood plasma, and so on, just to give some examples. So here, the contamination from DNA, RNA, DNAs, and RNAs may certainly ruin results. So we recommend to use ethylene oxide gas, essentially a sterilization gas, treated devices to ensure no contaminated molecules are present, or to rinse with ethanol, as I'll talk in a little while. And a kind of interesting point is that for all of our ECO treated devices, all of our staff that are relevant to that production are listed, their DNA is listed on governmental databases, just to make sure that if they do contaminate any forensics results, they won't be suspects in a crime. And I always kind of thought that would make an interesting twist for a murder mystery or a crime thriller. But so far, no TV bosses have taken up that idea. So also, because DNA is very precious within forensic samples and other samples, you want to negate the risk of any loss because the concentration is so low. So to help with this, we recommend the device passivation procedure using a blocking agent, and we'll show this a little bit later. And then likewise, collecting every last kind of nanogram of material is important. So here we'd recommend reverse centrifugal devices, which can essentially be spun upside down with maybe a half a milliliter of solution to flush out any of that residual target molecule. Now, washing, not in a reverse way, but washing normally will help to often remove kind of globular proteins from the membrane matrix. But with linear DNA molecules, we find that actually this may increase their binding. Not really too sure why it needs to be looked at in a bit more depth, but essentially it's hypothesized that the more spins and the more force is put on the molecules, the more they wrap themselves around the membrane matrices. So just to note that kind of washing post-concentration isn't so effective with linear nucleic acids. And as mentioned before, they have high recoveries with the horizontal RC and hydrosart membrane. So last but certainly not least, we have the cell culture applications. And as you imagine, they're very diverse depending upon the target. Again, after the kind of clarification procedure, ultrafiltration will start to come into play at the start of the downstream processing stage. And it will, you'll often find ultrafiltration before and after, or before and or after the purification, polishing, chromatography steps. Certainly, it's a core application in the life science industries, as the cell culture, that is, wide range of molecules. And In most cases, the primary use of ultrafiltration is for molecule concentration, but also for the desalting or buffer exchange, perhaps before the purification to make sure there's the right buffer conditions for the membrane or resin absorbers. Maintaining product quality and high yields is really key in this field. Centrifugal pressure and TFF systems are certainly most relevant. So we come on to some of the optimization consideration. The molecule characteristics, such as its ability to conformationally rearrange the isoelectric point, hydrophobicity and foothold and so on, certainly has quite a big impact on how it interacts with the membrane. So for that reason, we'd always recommend, if you want to optimize with a specific target, to test the different membranes and devices and compare those recovery rates, as we kind of showed from that earlier bit of data. Like with TFF, the concentration gradients may incur membrane polarization if that gradient swings too close towards membrane fouling. And this can have a detrimental impact, not just because it will start to reduce the flux and the speed of the separation, but also because it can cause molecule aggregation or even denaturing through enzymatic activity as proteases, for example, that might be left over from a cell lysate become kind of have a higher concentration with the target of interest, the protein of interest. So in these cases, it's a good idea to maybe reduce the RCF spin speed, just to reduce the push of that concentration gradient. Buffer exchange is often carried out in the dialysis bags that work excellently in terms of what they're meant to do, but they can take several hours plus an overnight step. So when it's all about reducing the time from specimen to report, we'd always recommend diafiltration because it can enable buffer exchange in 60 to 90 minutes, if not in parallel. Molecule precipitation may occur in over-concentrated samples, which will ruin the product. So here we recommend to reduce the spin time, maybe include that confluent in parallel buffer exchange or control using the final volume technique. So I was going to initially do a whole section on cell culture, but there quite simply wasn't enough time. And I think this kind of slide shows why, because for the variety of targets, from antibodies to viral vectors, messenger RNA, exosomes, and even polysaccharides that we're finding we're having some more and more queries of when it comes to ultrafiltration, you can see that ultrafiltration is relevant to each target workflow. Likewise with clarification and purification. So it's really is a primary tool in these cell culture workflows. And where we're always trying to reduce titer loss, it's an optimal area that can be optimized. So for cell culture specifically, I thought I'd maybe give some more clear-cut solutions. So for bioburden contamination, to reduce this, or a solution for this, carry out some pre-rinse procedures, carry out some sanitization procedures, and I'll show these in a little while. Use the ETO-treated devices if possible. And I say if possible because it is a limited range. We don't currently have ETO devices for 50 milliliters, for example. To prevent target degradation or denaturing due to unbalanced pH and shear stresses and so on, reduce the RCF, particularly for the linear molecules. Use a device closest to the minimum sample volume, because the higher the surface area, this helps to kind of reduce the membrane polarization. So in other words, if you use a 4 milliliter volume with a 4 to 20 milliliter device, then you know there's going to be a lot of surface area for that 4 milliliter sample. Use TFF or constant pressure devices to minimize those shear stresses. Use the parallel buffer exchange to prevent agglomeration or precipitation. And if relevant, place those centrifugal concentrators in refrigerated centrifuges if temperature has an impact. To prevent fouling, make sure you select that right molecular weight cutoff for each membrane and manufacturer device. And I'll mention as to why I've mentioned this in a little while, but rest assured that tighter doesn't always mean safer for the product. Ensure that the optimal membrane is being used. Do that testing to make sure there's no non-specific binding. And make sure the optimal spin time is identified, because you don't really want to over-concentrate. And with our devices becoming faster and faster, it's not always suitable to compare like for like. And we'd always recommend with our fast devices maybe going in with a slower a lesser time in the centrifuge. For general titer losses, you can use an angular dead stop device and post concentration rinses. And this is the kind of dead stop here. It's just angular, but it means that you collect every last microliter and no loss through holdup. Use reverse centrifugation devices if possible. Check that chemical compatibility, I should say, not computability, to ensure no membrane damage. And then if time to concentrate is a priority, ensure the right molecular weight cutoff is used. Two-type might capture more, but will be slower and can cause increasing pressures. Cold temperatures can certainly be useful if you're worried about your target denaturing, but if that's not a concern, use room temperature, as the cold temperatures do reduce the membrane passage dynamics. And use the optimal device per milliliter. So if you're working with one batch of 100 milliliters, use a VivaCell or a VivaFlow as opposed to several VivaSpin devices. And then finally, a kind of challenge here that we're seeing more and more, particularly for the emerging gene and cell therapeutics, is that the workflows aren't really standardized. So although this is generally thought to be more of a topic for, let's say, production workflows, optimization and process development is particularly for the critical lab ultrafiltration applications, should be carried out as needed. You should find some very positive impacts. So now we've kind of painted a picture of some of the key applications. I'll do a bit of a deeper dive into what you should kind of choose to optimize according to what was said earlier. So when it comes to the method consideration, whether you choose centrifugal, pressure, TFF, and so on, it really depends upon your sample priority. So if temperature control is critical, you can probably use any either refrigerated centrifuge device or put the TFF static in the cold room and so on. If flux control is important, then pressure and TFF work well. Maximum process speeds, however, you'd probably look to the VivaSpin turbo devices and TFF for the larger volumes. For the bioburden control, it'd be centrifugal and so on. I won't go through all of these points. I think that you'll be able to get access to this webinar recording. So feel free to come back to these if needed, or contact us in the future. So how to choose that right molecular weight cutoff? Membrane molecular weight cutoff is officially defined by the molecular weight of the smallest globular test protein that's 90% rejected by the membrane. So a 5K membrane should, in theory, retain 90% of all test proteins, 5 kilodalton or larger. But this rarely corresponds with the real life proteins that you found in the industry because of all of these variations to that protein, the shape, electropotential, the adsorption capacity and its rates, and then the subsequent reversibility. So this is why we generally always say that molecular weight of the ultrafiltration membrane should be 50% to one third the molecular of the molecular weight of the protein. So typically a 5K molecular weight should be used for 10 to 15 protein and so on. Now this endpoint here is quite interesting because it's worth noting that not different manufacturer molecular weight cutoffs will give different retention profiles. So in other words, it's a nominal value. So our 10 kilodalton will not necessarily be the same as 10 kilodalton from other manufacturers. It's kind of all relative to their own range. So for that reason, if you're using a 10 kilodalton from one supplier and you swap to another, you shouldn't take it as you'll get the same retention profiles, and it's probably worth testing with some samples. This is a slide I mentioned earlier, where if you're working with DNA or viruses, we have this in some of our technical selection guides, you can relate maybe the molecule size or the base pair length to the molecular weight cutoff of interest. Some tips, the lower molecular weight cutoffs may increase recoveries, but reduce the speed of concentration and separation. Higher molecular weight cutoffs, they have greater surface to molecule interaction, and they may actually create more non-specific binding as a result of that. And then crude fractionation can only be done with that tenfold size difference, as mentioned. So when choosing the membrane, we have, Sartorius is really in quite a good position because we have four go-to lab ultrafiltration membranes, so we can make sure that we have the perfect membrane for whatever the application. I think gone are the days where it was a kind of like a one-size-fits-all situation for filtration membranes. And I've just highlighted a few points to kind of show some of the key differences that you might look at. The polysulfone has a slight negative charge at neutral pH. It's that neutral pH, I should say. So therefore, it's really optimal for negatively charged proteins because it helps to retain and bounce back those molecules. The hydrosart, on the other hand, has the highest chemical compatibility. So it's very good for inorganic work. And then the cellulose triacetate, it doesn't have that membrane support material, as I mentioned. So therefore, it's very good for filtrate collection, sample cleaning, and protein removal. So looking at TFF, if TFF is a method to go for at lab, there are a ton of parameters with TFF alone, and certainly it warrants its own presentation. You can see the list here on the left-hand side. And really what I just wanted to highlight with this slide is that early lab stage optimization can really increase performance and can be considered. If you take this example, it's the same pump setting, which essentially incurs the same pump flow rate, more or less, you know, around the 300 to 320 mark. But with the different molecular weight cutoffs, 3, 100, even a 0.2, you can see a very different profile of retentate versus filtrate in each. So in other words, you can't necessarily transfer one procedure flow rate from one membrane molecular weight cutoff to another. So having a deeper dive into the TFF, just some statements here. The flux, that separation efficiency, it's really dependent upon the transmembrane pressure. If the TMP is too high, the flux will kind of plateau, reach its maximum, and then that's where you can actually get some membrane fouling and shear stresses. And this membrane fouling may actually reduce the flux and damage the target. So if you can develop one of these flux curves, the best place is to set your pump speed or flow rate or essentially at value just before where the flux starts to hit the plateau. And I did want to put in a graph to show that, and apologize I haven't been able to before the talk. A larger membrane will incur the greater product loss because of that membrane holdup. So do consider that. There's no need to make an excessive membrane size just to reduce speed. TFF is generally very fast in any case. However, it's a bit of a balance because a smaller membrane may increase that TMP too far. So you want to optimize the parameters according to the different sizes of the device. And again, don't transfer settings without a kind of scale up formula. The target might precipitate if overconcentrated. So in this case, run in parallel with diafiltration buffer exchange. And that there's a lot of time and effort that might go into getting these optimal results. So really you want to utilize a kind of lab-based TFF if possible, simply because the lab-based cassettes that we develop, they're designed to have this increased turbulence that helps to mitigate that membrane polarization and so on, which some of the process stuff doesn't have. So it's a little bit more, let's say, less sensitive to the different parameters. So now we're going to maybe explain some of these key sample device treatments that I mentioned. Pre-rinsing, sanitization, and so on. And I just want to note that these, we've got one slide for each. We do have quite an extensive range of application notes, certainly one for each of these. So if you're interested in more detailed procedural information, just by all means get in touch and we're happy to send those over. So in terms of the pre-rinsing, the ultrafiltration membranes contain preservative, typically glycerin or glycerol. And this is needed for all ultrafiltration membranes across the industry, as it helps to prevent the membranes from drying out and the pores kind of collapsing. It's also worth noting that further contaminants may be found in the reuse device, the multi-use devices. So we recommend using appropriate rinse or buffer solution concentrations, such as EDTA for the metal ions, 0.5 sodium hypochlorite for PES, general cleaning, and so on, prior to use, to remove these peaks. And you would do this just by rinsing the solution for a 5-minute spin with a centrifugal concentrator, or perhaps for 10 minutes in a TFF. And you can see with the figures 1 and 2 over here, quite the stark difference it has using NMR. A couple of things to consider though. So obviously the benefits of your removal of the peaks and so on, pardon me. But a couple of things to consider, those rinse solutions may also result in any unwanted kind of peaks. So it's worth noting that they're there and essentially making sure they don't overlap with any of your target peaks. Once rinsed as well, whether that be centrifugal or TFF, the membrane must be used or stored immediately to prevent that drying out. So looking at sanitization, as I mentioned, we do offer some ETO sanitized devices. Users are of course welcome to take the devices and carry out this gas sanitization themselves if that's possible. But if not, you can rinse with 70% ethanol and that will help to reduce the bioburden. One thing to note is that these ETO treated products do not come certified. So we do not currently offer certified pre-sterilized devices. We know this is kind of a hot topic, particularly in the virus world, and we're always happy for input on that. But so far, they don't come certified as sterile or endotoxin-free. They just come ETO treated. However, we do have some nice data, as you can see on the right, that shows, for example, after ETO treatment, no human genomic DNA was found after amplification with PCR. There's no impact on speed of concentration with the treatment. And then likewise, there's no significant effect on the recovery of DNA either, where you can see without treatment, in this case, it was 31%. With treatment, it was 38% recovery. And then similar kind of standard deviation in the next one. So obviously the big benefit here is removal of the bioburden DNA contaminants, and helping to protect the quality and integrity, particularly when it comes to endotoxins and so on. So passivation, this is really for low concentration products. Essentially, prior to concentration, you can wash the devices with a blocking agent, and these blocking agents will bind to, let's say, the non-specific binding points in the membrane surface and the housing, typically pegged tween, even diluted milk protein can be used. It's really important to note, however, not to, you know, the blocking agent or passivation solution has to be specific for the product to the extent that you don't want it to be harmful to the product. So Triton X, for example, performs very badly with exosomes, or it damages the exosome. So we wouldn't recommend it for that. The passivation solution can just be passed through one or two spins under a low RCF, but for maximum effect, the solution should really be left overnight in the device. And this is great because what it will mean is that you'll be able to capture all of the low concentration targets, particularly when it's in the nanogram range. As you can kind of see here, untreated, maybe a 23% recovery with very low concentration. But once it's treated, that's doubled, near enough, kind of tripled. Yeah, helps to reduce loss of precious sample. Again, like with the pre-rinsing, these buffer products, they might contaminate those final peaks or spectroscopy results and so on. So when it comes to final volume control, you can do this kind of manually. It's kind of important because it's quite difficult to estimate with centrifugal concentrators when you've hit the concentration factor you want, because of course it's in a centrifuge. With the method development from the table A, users can qualify the volumes and times requirements according to their own needs. However, this can be kind of quite time consuming. So one really cool thing that you can do is you can remove that time dependency by essentially pre-filling the filtrate tube with DI water or buffer that you're after. And this will set a concentration factor or concentration volume maximum. So for example, here you can see that with a 15 milliliter sample, maybe you want to concentrate it 10 times to 1.5. You can add 11.5 milliliters of water into the filtrate tube, and the device will not be able to concentrate greater than that. So that really helps to prevent any overconcentration and molecule precipitation, removes the labor cost of figuring out the spin times, and also it negates the risks the variables have on the qualified spin time. So in other words, once you've gone through the process of qualifying the spin time, maybe there's an issue with the membrane or the sample that might kind of negate those spin times anyway. So the final one for the sample and device treatment is the buffer exchange. It's a big topic. I think I've mentioned it in pretty much every application, and it is really critical to maintain optimal sample conditions. Of course, there are the dialysis bags, but just for the purposes of this talk, you know, we focus on the faster ultrafiltration. You can do a manual diafiltration using centrifugal concentrators. So image A over here, for example. You fill your sample, you concentrate as normal, you then decant the wasted filtrate, you then refill with a buffer of your choosing, spin again, and then your concentrated product will be in the new buffer with the optimal conditions that you can aspirate. Maybe you might have to do this a couple of times, really depends upon the sample. That takes about 90 minutes, so already a lot quicker than the dialysis bags. However, we've got a nice couple of features which you can do this step completely in parallel. So for example, image B down here, this is our VivaSpin 20 device. And this item here is called a diafiltration cup. You can fill this with your buffer solution of interest, place that into the concentrate insert, screw on the cap, put it through a normal centrifugation run. And as the sample concentrates and goes into the filtrate, the new buffer will drip into the concentrate and provide a kind of confluent process. So you're essentially jumping from step one all the way to step seven, which again reduces the time probably about 50%, 50 to 100%. And then likewise, you can do that with the TFF. So here, for example, is your sample reservoir. And I apologize if these images are a little bit too small. But here we have the sample reservoir. As it concentrates, as filtrate goes, a void is formed in this sealed reservoir, and that void, that vacuum caused, will essentially aspirate up the buffer, the fresh buffer. So the greater the concentration, the more buffer is brought in. And of course, the benefits here again, prevents that over-concentration, prevents conformational rearrangements for the changing buffer conditions, and helps to maintain the IE point that you need. Allows rapid desorting and removes that need for several hour long buffer exchange. Cool, so just kind of a couple of slides on the trials and application development, because I think what we've kind of shown is that although we can offer some relatively specific guidance per application, each application and sub-application, or each target and sub-target, kind of requires its own considerations and its own assessment by the users to know what specific parameters and procedures are best. So to support with this to date, we have one of the widest ranges of the products themselves with 20 different product ranges. We're increasing our technical selection guides. I think some might be attached to this webinar, but we always have some more. We have, I think, the largest range of lab ultrafiltration application notes available with over 30, and we're going to be bringing more and more out all the time. We have the application team and the product specialist team. And we keep saying it's always worth testing. We're always happy to support with that, with sampling regimes and so on. And then further to that, we represent the laboratory side of things, which is certainly critical to researchers, but also for most processes, it's always kind of good to know how you can scale up if you need to, particularly when it comes to the cell culture stuff. And we have that close relationship with our bioprocess division for easy handovers and so on. But that being said, there's still a lot more applications for us to understand, a lot more products for us to develop and optimize. And for that reason, we're always very interested in engaging with the industry key opinion leaders to help influence our future product developments. We're always keen on collaborating with the frontier researchers for joint application development, and of course, partnering with those application relevant companies for ongoing and future product development. So I guess in this, I mean more beta trials, alpha trials, partnerships on development. They work extremely well. And if anyone happens to be one of our CDPs, We're certainly very grateful for those relationships. So if any of this is of interest, please don't hesitate to get in touch, and then we will start the conversation as soon as we can. So yeah, I think to end on a summary slide, a diverse range of lab ultrafiltration relevant applications, got many application-specific lab ultrafiltration considerations. There are a number of procedural changes that can improve the performance for each application. If you ever find you're not hitting the recoveries that you need, molecular weight, cutoff, a membrane, the different methods, the treatments, the sample control, and so on. We've got a wide range of products and application data to help support with these procedural changes. Where it's missing, If you feel like there's any application missing, then we're interested to know about it and generating and filling that gap. And as such, we're always open for those collaborations. So with that, I think I'll say thank you for the time. Pretty much been an hour, which is good. And yeah, if there's any questions, we can open up now.
Great. Thank you so much for that presentation, Adam. And as a reminder to our audience, you may submit your questions to Adam or Klaus using the Q&A tab at any time. And we do already have some questions, so we'll get straight to them. I know Klaus is having a few audio issues right now, but I'm sure Adam will be able to answer some of these questions. The first question is, how do I know if I'm experiencing protein degradation, and how can I prevent this?
Yeah, good question. And I guess the first part of that, you say, how do you know if you're experiencing it? It's kind of quite down to your own benchmarks. If it's a completely new protein, then of course literature reviews and peer reviews and so on. And then if you feel like there is some denaturization or degradation, then the first steps would be considering things like the pH and the optimal buffer conditions. I think in anticipation of some of these questions, it's kind of cheating the answer a little bit, but Buffer conditions, the high shear stresses are certainly going to be a topic for degradation, so you can reduce those g-forces, reduce the RCF and so on. And then when it comes to the membrane itself, maybe it's not denaturing, but if you have a very kind of sticky protein, it might be sticking to the membrane, so you might be worth having a look to see if there's a new membrane that you can use or that's more optimal for the protein.
Okay, great. Thank you, Adam. And the next question is, how do I know what membrane is the best membrane to choose?
Yeah, again, a very tough question. And the surefire way of answering it is to test. We're always happy to provide those free of charge samples. What we do have documented is the specifications of the membrane, as I think I kind of showed in an earlier slide. And we can't, let's say, have the application resource to develop an application note dedicated for each individual protein. So what we do offer are a range of literature reviews. I think we have some for nanoparticles and viruses. And from that, you can kind of see what works best in the industry, what membrane for what target and so on. In the future as well, we're hoping to get a benchmarking application note that I think will be very good at establishing maybe for 30 different proteins or viruses, what membrane will be good. So we'll help to increase that data set. So in summary, the clear way is to test, and other than that, literature reviews and checking with us for our membrane specifications.
Okay, great, thank you. And for how long can I reuse my devices?
It depends. Officially, if it's single use, it shouldn't be reused. To look at that question more, the centrifugal concentrators, they are all single use. However, they have been rated for, let's say, 5 spins. So essentially 2 rinses, 1 concentration, and maybe 2 washes. However, it should be noted that they really do have to be used in the same time period. So once you've done one rinse, you have to finish using it, because if that membrane dries out, you will the membrane will be damaged. When it comes to the reuse devices, such as the VivaFlow, essentially whenever the flux starts to deteriorate or the speed of separation starts to reduce, then you kind of know that you probably need to get another one. Really depends upon the sample, how easy it can be cleaned. I know some metal chelates are quite difficult to remove, for example, whereas some proteins are very easy and you'll be able to get more lifespan out of that VivaFlow.
Okay, great. Thank you. And the next question is, what do I do if my target seems to go through into the filtrate?
The first step would probably be to assess the right molecular weight cutoff. You can get, particularly the globular proteins, can slip through. So it's worth, you know, we say use a membrane that's, use a molecular weight cutoff that's 1/2 to 1/3. If it's very globular, I would say try a lower molecular weight cutoff. After that, I guess you could also check the chemical compatibilities to make sure there's no damage to the membrane is occurring. But generally, it's to reduce the molecular weight cutoff and then go from there.
Okay, thank you. And the next question is, where can I find the application and technical support material?
The website is always a good choice, for sure. However, it's probably worth noting we're going through a rebranding at the moment. You might have seen from the new style, and as such, our website is constantly being updated. If you ever have any difficulty in getting hold of any material, if you want this list of 30 application notes, please feel free to reach out to myself or info@Sartorius or your local Sartorius contact, and they'll be able to provide you with all the material.
Okay, great. Thank you. Can you use ultrafiltration with low molecular weight peptides, say that are less than 3,000 Daltons?
Yeah, certainly you can. What can't be guaranteed is the recoveries. I think as we saw in the earlier example, the 6.5 TFF1 protein, that that's having recoveries, optimal recoveries, around the kind of 50% mark. We've got a couple of application notes on peptides, but the And they show recoveries ranging from kind of 40 to 60%. So absolutely you can do. However, if you need, let's say, 95% plus recoveries, might be worth looking at alternative methods.
Okay, thank you so much, Adam. Unfortunately, that's all we have for today. If you have any further questions, please consider reaching out to the speakers directly. The email addresses are shown on the screen right now. And as a reminder, the webinar will be archived on the Scientist website, and you'll receive an email notifying you when the on-demand webinar is available. I would like to thank everyone who took the time to join us today, and particularly those of you who shared your questions and comments. On behalf of the Scientist, I'd also like to thank our speaker, Mr. Alan Green, and also Klaus for joining us, as well as our sponsor, Sartorius. Thanks, everyone, and goodbye.